Hello friends, welcome back to this online refresher course in education under ARPIT 2019 by National Resource Center for Education, Central University of South Bihar, Gaya. The title of this course is, as we said in the first part, Concerns in Educational Research and Assessment. I am Arvind Kumar Jha from Baba Sahab Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Lucknow, and this is the next part, that is the part 2 of the topic, that is Qualitative Paradigms of Research. Basic Paradigms of Research. There are three paradigms in research which are generally discussed, deliberated and debated to contextualize any educational research. These are positivist, post-positivist and critical theory. As far as the post-positivist is concerned, we talk about interpretivist or constructivist also. Let us discuss each one in greater detail in terms of theory. Ontological assumptions, epistemological assumptions, main thinkers and their philosophies, and limitations of each paradigm. Let's start with the positivism and post-positivism. First proposed by French philosopher Auguste Comte. I'm talking about the positivism. The positivist paradigm defines a worldview to research which is grounded in what is known in research methods as the scientific method of investigation. Comte postulated that experimentation, observation and reason based on experience ought to be the basis for understanding human behavior, and therefore the only legitimate means of extending knowledge and human understanding. In the pure form, the scientific method involves a process of experimentation that is used to explore observations and answer questions. It is used to search for cause and effect relationships in nature. It is chosen as the preferred worldview for research, which tries to interpret observations in terms of facts or measurable entities. Research located in this paradigm relies on deductive logic, formulation of hypotheses, testing those hypotheses, offering operational definitions and mathematical equations, calculations, extrapolations and expressions to derive conclusions. It aims to provide explanations and to make predictions based on measurable outcomes. Those measurable outcomes are undergirded by four assumptions that Cohen, Mannion and Morrison have explained. And these are determinism, empiricism, parsimony and generalizability. An unpacking of each of these assumptions helps researchers understand better the meaning and expectations of research conducted within this paradigm. Briefly, the assumption of determinism measures that the events we observe are caused by other factors. Therefore, if we are to understand causal relationships among factors, we need to be able to make predictions and to control the potential impacts of the explanatory factors on the dependent factors. The assumption of empiricism means that for us to be able to investigate a research problem, we need to be able to collect verifiable empirical data which support the theoretical framework chosen for your research and enable you to test the hypothesis you formulated. In assuming parsimony, the positivist paradigm refers to the researcher's attempts to explain the phenomena they study in the most economic way possible. Finally, the generalizability assumption tells us that the results obtained from a research project conducted within the positivist paradigm in one context should be applicable to other situations by inductive inferences. This means that the positivist researcher should be able to observe occurrences in the particular phenomenon they have studied and be able to generalize about what can be expected elsewhere in the world. Because of these assumptions, the positivist paradigm advocates the use of quantitative research methods as the bedrock for the researcher's ability to precise in the descriptions of the parameters and coefficients in the data that are gathered, analyzed, and interpreted, so as to understand relationships embedded in the data analyzed. And so, in terms of the four fundamental elements or assumptions of a paradigm for the positivist paradigms, its epistemology is said to be objectivist. I underline, its epistemology is said to be objectivist. Its ontology is a naive realism. Its methodology is experimental, and its axiology is the beneficence, nothing else. Again, unpacking each of these elements should help the researcher understand better this paradigm. The objectivist epistemology holds that human understanding is gained through the application of research. This implies that through research, we can acquire knowledge which increasingly approximates the real nature of what it is that we investigate. In other words, through more objective in understanding the world around us, the naive realist ontology assumes the acceptance of the following five beliefs. The first, which is very important, there exists a world of material objects. Number two, some statements about these objects can be known to be true through sense experiences. Number three, these objects exist whether they are actually perceived or even when they are not perceived. These objects of perception are assumed to be largely perception interdependent. Fourth, these objects are also able to retain properties of the types we perceive them as having, even when they are not being perceived. Their properties are perception interdependent. Last but not the least, by means of our senses, we perceive the world directly and pretty much as it is. In the main, our claims to have knowledge of it are justified. Now, friends, I'll be talking about the experimental methodology. The experimental methodology statement means that the research will involve manipulation of one variable to determine whether changes in that variable cause changes in another variable. The former variable is called the explanatory or predictive variable, and the latter variable is called the explained or dependent variable. This methodology can only apply if we are able to control what happens to the variables or the subjects we study. Such control enables the researcher to test and accept or reject the hypothesis. This beneficence axiology referred to the requirement that all research should aim at maximizing good outcomes for the research project, for humanity in general, and for the research participants. It also implies that the research should aim at avoiding or at least minimizing any risk or harm or wrong that could occur during the research. Now, friends, this is in short the positivist based. But the very important for the qualitative is the post-positivism. Let me talk about the post-positivism. What is this? Post-positivism is stepped forward as a reaction of educational researchers to the limitations of positivism as a paradigm. Educational researchers discovered that positivism cannot fulfill the requirements for social scientist research as it bases itself on observable and empirical analytical facts. As a reaction to its orthodox nature towards quantitative empirical analytic based research, the researchers of social sciences and education came with the data of mixed paradigm combining positivism and interpretivism and making a new paradigm named post-positivism. As far as the post-positivism is concerned, the post-positivism is a certain pluralism which balances both positivist and interpretivist approaches. It focuses on researching issues in the context of involving experiences of the majority and enhancing the results of what the majority says is acceptable. Whereas post-positivism, along with quantitative analysis, includes the perspectives of historical, comparative, philosophical, and phenomenological analysis. Although post-positivist research scientifically strives to explore the phenomena, it believes, unlike positivist research, that the absolute truth is nowhere to be found. Post-positivism does not aim to disapprove the scientific or quantitative elements of positivism in the research. Rather, it emphasizes a proper understanding of the directions and perspectives of any research study from multiple dimensions and multi-methods. It is a justification for alternative paradigm. In other words, it is a revolt against limitations of positivism. Ontological assumptions of positivism. As far as the ontological assumptions of positivism is concerned, it very clearly states, reality is external to the researcher and represented by objects in space. Objects have meaning independently of any consciousness of them, and reality can be captured by our senses and predicted also. Along with each ontological assumptions, you can have each one epistemological assumptions. But let me talk about first the epistemological assumptions of positivism. The methodology of the natural sciences should be employed to study social reality. Truth can be attained because knowledge rests on a set of firm, unquestionable, indisputable truths from which our beliefs may be deduced. The third epistemological assumption is, knowledge is generated deductively from a theory or hypothesis, and knowledge is objective. So what you can do, on the one hand, you can write all the ontological assumptions. On the other hand, you can write all the epistemological assumptions so that you can have a comparative picture along the line of epistemological and ontological assumptions of this, and which is very clearly indicated in the following diagram. Now I'll be talking about who are the main thinkers and their the philosophies. Friends, here I would like to underline and emphasize that you cannot become a good researcher if you are not a good reader. So theoretically, make yourself sound and sound. Read more and more to become a good researcher. So to understand positivism in a holistic way, I would like to suggest who are the main thinkers you should concentrate and their philosophical stance you should be familiar with. For example, you must study Aristotle, particularly his deductive reasoning, Descartes, and particularly his contribution to realism, then Galileo, scientific method, Auguste Comte, this particularly the positivism, the Vienna Circle, logical positivism, and Francis Bacon, inductive reasoning. And all these, when you study, not only that, then you study the Karl Popper, who talks about post-positivism. So positivism and post-positivism should be studied simultaneously. But friends, as I said in the beginning, each paradigm has got its own limitations. So the positivism has also its limitations. Let me first talk about the limitations of positivism. Despite Karl Popper has criticized positivism heavily with sound logic. But I would like to state here, despite Popper's criticism, the question is, the certainty that one can apply a methodology used to research a natural science to research a social science. So why not the same can be applied from the natural science to the social science if I want to understand any phenomena in its certainty? There is a disagreement that positivist scientific provides us with the clearest possible ideal knowledge. Even if you are falsifying a hypothesis, instead of affirming it, you are still assuming that this research is objective and reflects social reality. No matter how stringently a scientist adheres to the scientific method, and there is never an outcome that is objective. And that's why objective reality is always a questionable one. Although behavioral uniformities exist, they are not evidence of an underlying essential uniformity among entities, but an illusion, a social construction, as Erikson has said. The critical theorist Habermas emphasizes the determinist view of science as the ideal knowledge which ignores the moral choices, values, and judgments scientists make while conducting his or her scientific research. Furthermore, theory should be as simple and concise as possible, and it is impossible for any theory in social science in general and in the field of education in particular to be simple and precise. Why? Because the world we live in and people's multiple perspective and interpretations of events make theories very, very complex and chaotic. So many variables affect different events and people's actions that it is impossible to determine an absolute truth. The above criticism led to the formation of different paradigm, and that paradigm is known as the interpreted paradigm, which is generally discussed under the broad heading of post-positivist paradigm. So now let me concentrate on interpretivist paradigm. Friends, the interpretivist paradigm can be also called the anti-positivist paradigm. Why? Because it was developed as a reaction to positivism. It is also sometimes referred to as constructivism. Why? Because it emphasizes the ability of the individual to construct the meaning. It facilitates understanding of how and why, and enables the researcher to be alive to changes which occur and good at understanding social processes. The interpretivist paradigm was heavily influenced by hermeneutics and phenomenology. What is hermeneutics? Hermeneutics is the study of meaning and interpretation in historical text and context. This meaning-making cyclical process is the basis on which the interpretivist paradigm was established. Another strong influence is the philosophical movement, and that movement is known as phenomenological movement or existential movement. A phenomenologist advocates the need to consider human beings' subjective interpretations, their perception of the world, that is, their life worlds, which matter the most for any individual, as our starting point in understanding social phenomena. Therefore, the ontological assumptions of interpretivism are that social reality is seen by multiple people, and these multiple people interpret events differently, leaving multiple perspectives of an incident. Interpretivism's main tenet is that the researcher can never be objectively observed from the outside, rather it must be observed from inside through the direct experience of the people. Uniform causal links that can be established in the study of natural science cannot be made in the world of the classroom, where teachers and learners construct meaning. The role of the scientist in the interpretivist paradigm is to understand, explain, and demystify social reality through the eyes of different participants. So the concept of teaching will not be same The concept of learning will not remain same. Even the concept of assessment cannot be the same. But before I talk all these things, let me talk about the ontological assumptions of interpretivists, and then I'll be talking about epistemological assumptions of interpretivists. And for that, there is a table. You can always compare, have a table in front of you and then see. So let me start with the ontological assumptions of interpretivists. The first assumption is, as far as the ontology of post-positivism or interpretivism is concerned, reality is indirectly constructed based on individual interpretation and is subjective, not objective. People interpret and make their own meaning of events. Events are distinctive and cannot be generalized. There are multiple perspectives on one incident. Causation in social science is determined by interpreted meaning and symbols. Now, along with this, let's compare the epistemological assumptions of interpretivists. Knowledge is gained through a strategy that respects the differences between people and the objects of natural sciences. And therefore, it requires the social scientist to grasp the subjective meaning of social action. Knowledge is gained inductively to create a theory. Knowledge arises from particular situations and is not reducible to simplistic interpretation. Knowledge is gained through personal experience. But to understand in a better way, I would like to talk about who are the main thinkers who have contributed in the development of interpretivist theory as a research methods. As I said earlier, friends, you need to study extensively. And who are those? Firstly, I would like to recommend you must study Husserl, Arthur Schulze, because they have contributed in the development of phenomenology. And you can use phenomenology as one of the research methodologies in your educational research. You should also study Wilhelm Dilthey, Hank George Gardner. Why? Because they have contributed a theory which is known as a research methodology, hermeneutics. Please read Herbert Blumer, who has really given a very, very profound theory called symbolic interaction. You should also consult Harold Garfinkel, who really has talked about ethnomethodology. But as I said in the beginning, each paradigm has its own limitation. So interpretivist paradigm has also its limitation. Let me talk about the limitations of interpretivism. It abandons the scientific procedure of verification, and therefore results cannot be generalized to situations, to all situations rather. The strongest criticism of interpretivism is that it neglected to acknowledge the political and ideological influences on knowledge and social reality. And education is a social reality. As a phenomena, it's a social reality. While the positivist researcher seeks to explain social phenomena and the interpretivist researcher seeks to understand social phenomena, the researcher who seeks to change and to challenge social phenomena is not represented. This concern is addressed in the critical paradigm, which I'm going to talk about before I conclude my talk. Friends, now let me talk about the critical paradigm in terms of its ontological assumption, in terms of its epistemological assumptions. Also, I'll be talking about its limitations, and then finally, what we need to do as a researcher. As far as the critical paradigm is concerned, let me tell you that the critical paradigm stems from critical theory and the belief that research is conducted for the emancipation of individuals and groups in an egalitarian society. The critical educational researcher aims not only to understand or give an account of behaviors in societies, but to change these behaviors. The critical paradigm embodies different ideologies such as postmodernism. It embraces neo-Marxism and feminism. Critical theory originated from the criticism that educational research was too technical and concerned with only efficiency and rationality of decision, neglecting social inequalities and issues of power, as Gaya has said. And according to critical theorists, researchers should be looking for the political and economic foundations of our construction of knowledge, curriculum, teaching, learning, so on and so forth. Schools play an explicit part in this construction of knowledge based on power in society. In other words, education serves the interest of those who have power, usually rich people in all the societies. Schools function to reproduce these inequalities and maintain the status quo. Educational research in the critical paradigm should challenge these reproductions of inequalities. People must challenge dominant discourses. And I would like to state here, dominance of any sort must be challenged. Educational research and schools, like other social institutions such as the media and the legislature, must be the scenes of the necessary struggles for power. Moreover, this research has an agenda to change the participants' lives or the structures of the institution, even the structure of the society itself. Following are the main epistemological and ontological assumptions of critical theory. Let me first start with ontological assumptions of this. You know, as I said earlier, social reality defined from persons in society. Social reality is a socially constructed through media, institutions, and society. Social behavior is the outcome of particular illegitimate, dominatory, and repressive factors. Illegitimate in the sense that they do not operate in general interest. One person's or group's freedom and power is bought at the price of another's freedom and power, as Cohen has said. Now, keeping these ontological assumptions in mind, let's draw a parallel epistemological assumptions of this. Knowledge is socially constructed through media, institutions, and society. What counts as worthwhile knowledge is determined by the social and positional power of the advocates of that knowledge. Knowledge is produced by power and is an expression of power rather than truth. But friends, I have a suggestion here. To understand critical theory, you need to study thinkers in a wider and at in-depth level to understand it in a better way. So who are the people whom you should study, and particularly their contributions as a research methodology? I'm going to suggest few names, but not these are all. There could be many more. Like Adorno, then you can study Herbert Marcuse. You can also study Eric Fromm. You can also study Karl Popper, Habermas, Paul Freire, Michael Foucault, and many others. So, whose thinking you should concentrate on? I'll be talking about the main thinkers alongside the philosophies. Like, you need to study Theodore Adorno, Max Horkheimer, and Eric Fromm. And for this, the critical theory of 1930s, as known as Frankfurt School and critical theory. You should also consult Karl Popper and Habermas for the critical theories as dominant or prominent in 1970s. Paul Freire, critical pedagogy. Then Michael Foucault, structuralism. Then also Penny Cook, critical applied linguistics. Also Fairclough, critical discourse analysis. You can also talk about the Sedgwick and the Butler, particularly the queer theory. And you can also talk about Simone de Beauvoir and Betty Friedan, particularly the feminism. And you can also talk about Thomas Kuhn, Jacques Derrida, and others for the postmodernist theories. And you can apply these as a research methodology to conduct your research. But as I said, every paradigm has its own limitations. Now I'll be talking about the limitations of critical paradigm. Critical theory is criticized for its elitism. By assuming that everyone needs to be emancipated, critical theorists assume that they have been emancipated and therefore are better equipped to analyze society and transform it than someone else. Furthermore, there is a lack of evidence that illustrates what happens when you become emancipated and gain a critical consciousness. Is there any evidence that shows that once someone attains a critical consciousness, he or she stops reproducing inequalities that subtly oppress people? Furthermore, positivists criticize critical research for their deliberate political agenda and failure to remain an objective, neutral research. Critical pedagogy is criticized for the limited work on concrete teacher practices. Self-proclaimed critical pedagogues are left to their own devices to translate this framework into their everyday teaching. Other scholars question the approaches of critical pedagogy and argue that critical pedagogy is not always suitable for the periphery and is informed by pedagogical assumptions that are not always in line with the local communities and students' expectations and preferences. There are thinkers like Moshin, Perkins, and others. They have warned against critical pedagogues thinking that students have freedom to transcend the institutionalized forms of power and in the classroom to engage creative linguistic experimentation and text production. Now friends, whatever I have said, I would like to conclude. The definition of educational research has always been critical inquiry aimed at informing educational judgments in order to improve educational action. The educational practice has a broader moral purpose, and educational research has a moral obligations to address these social and political and educational inequalities. Last but not the least, do you think that it is important to understand the importance of epistemological, ontological, axiological, and methodological in educational research? If yes, pursue it for better understanding. If not, forget everything and do your research as you are doing. Friends, I hope that you would have enjoyed the session, and thanks for watching this video. Namaskar.